associate emeriti lecturer in this series. I'm pleased that so many of you braved the weather. It occurred to me that we have a solution for our water shortage. We just need to have more events like this. My name is I'm Michael Nauenberg. I'm a physicist, a former physicist. And our speaker today, Lincoln Taiz, is a former member of the biology department. He's asked me to keep this introduction very short, so I promise to take only a minute or two. You can get further details of his career, in the website of the biology department. I will just give you some salient features. He's the co-author of a major textbook. See if I can. Of a major textbook in plant physiology, and only a few weeks ago he told me he had completed the sixth edition of his work. He, in addition to teaching his courses in biology and plant physiology, he's one of these rare scientists who is also interested in the history, and he has given lectures about the history of plants from back to Babylonian times, and he's also published articles on the history with his wife, Sandra. This is one of the articles he sent me some time ago. By the way, if you're interested in the name Taiz, and if you Google it, you'll find out that it's the capital, an ancient capital, the 12th century of Yemen. And when I asked him, he said, yeah, his ancestors came from that city. So that is at least the origin of his name. Recently, he gave the keynote lecture at a conference in Brazil on the topic that he's going to cover today, which, as you know, is the one that's listed above. Now, he asked that all your questions be left to the end of his talk. We will have microphones that will then be passed to people who want to ask questions. So please leave them, leave the questions for later on. And join me in welcoming Lincoln Taiz.
I've never worn one of these ear microphones. It seems to be working. I can hear it echoing across the expanse. So all is well. Well, thank you, Michael, for keeping that introduction crisp, not crispy.
Not crispy.
Yes. As we gaze at our majestic blue planet as seen from space, it's difficult to believe that a single species could cause mass extinctions and alter Earth's climate. But that is exactly what is happening. Simply put, we humans have been too clever by half, and our reproductive success has brought on the four major challenges we face today. The four horsemen have different names today. They are loss of biodiversity, pollution, climate change, and food insecurity. I'm going to touch on all of these topics in tonight's talk, but my focus will be on food security because that involves plants. In recognition of the crucial importance of food security, President Napolitano has recently inaugurated the UC Global Food Initiative. My talk will be divided into four parts. The first part will describe the historical relationship between crop yields and population growth. Next, I'll discuss some of the many factors, including climate change, that are restricting further increases in crop productivity. In the third part, I'll talk about advances in plant genetic engineering that may help us to meet some of these challenges. In the fourth part of the talk, I'll show how increasing soil carbon content could simultaneously mitigate global warming and increase crop productivity. Finally, I hope to convince you that we need an integrated approach if we are to guarantee that our children and grandchildren will enjoy the same abundance of food and quality of life that we enjoy. Modern humans evolved some 200,000 years ago, and for most of that time, they survived as hunter-gatherers. By 8,000 BCE, the population had increased to about 10 million people. The invention of agriculture eventually led to urbanization, and the population had grown to perhaps 50 million by the Bronze Age. By the year 1 CE, the population had increased to 250 million before reaching its first billion by the middle of the 18th century. After that, the human population increased to 7 billion in just 200 years. By 2050, we're supposed to reach 10 billion. In 1798, when the human population was only 1 billion, the British cleric Thomas Malthus published his famous essay on the principle of population, in which he compared the exponential growth of human populations to the linear growth of the food supply, and predicted that population growth would quickly outstrip our ability to feed ourselves. Contrary to Malthus's predictions, however, food production not only kept up with population growth, it has become a driver of population growth. As noted by Jared Diamond, agriculture has been an autocatalytic process that catalyzes itself in a positive feedback cycle. Each major advance in agriculture was accompanied by an increase in the rate of population growth. In this schematic graph, there are three major inflection points. First, the Neolithic agricultural revolution, which began at around 10,000 years ago. As we shall see, the Neolithic revolution was the golden age of crop creation, the most radical period in the history of agriculture, which brought about far more genetic modifications to wild species than has since been achieved by either classical breeding or genetic engineering. By definition, all domesticated plants and animals are genetically modified organisms. Second, the irrigation revolutions of the Near East, which began around 3000 BCE and gave rise to the great civilizations of Egypt, Mesopotamia, and the Indus Valley. And third, the medieval and modern agricultural periods, which began around 1000 CE. Let's examine the relationship between agriculture and population in a little more detail, beginning with the agricultural revolution, which enabled the human population to grow to 50 million people. In this and several other slides to follow, the population level is shown in the green bar on the left, and the contemporary advances in agriculture are shown in the yellow boxes on the right. The long green arrows connect the advances with each stage of population growth. Around 8000 BCE, modern humans began to live in permanent settlements located near abundant wild food supplies. They soon began planting gardens, and this led to the domestication of three types of staple crops: cereals, legumes, and roots or tubers. Some examples are shown on the slide. The earliest domesticated food crops were in the Fertile Crescent and included emmer and einkorn wheat, barley, pea, lentil, chickpea, and bitter vetch. The combination of either cereals and legumes or roots and tubers and legumes provided all the energy and essential amino acids needed for human nutrition. Agriculture arose independently at least seven times around the world, in the Near East, South China, North China, Sub-Saharan Africa, South Central Andes, Central Mexico, and the Eastern United States. Each center of domestication generated its own suite of crop species. For example, rice and millet were the primary domesticates in Asia. Sorghum was domesticated in Africa. Maize, squash, and beans were domesticated in Mexico. South America gave us the potato and sweet potato, and North America domesticated sunflowers. Early plant domestication, unlike animal domestication, did not involve any plant breeding. Plant sex wasn't discovered until the late 17th, early 18th centuries. Domestication in plants involved selection for a range of favorable traits. For example, during wheat domestication, there was unconscious selection for mutants with non-shattering ears that wouldn't fall apart during harvesting. You can easily recognize the wild forms because the spikelets have smooth abscission zones. In contrast, the spikelets of domesticated wheat varieties all have rough surfaces where the rachis breaks during threshing. In addition, the domesticated wheat varieties have larger seeds and germinate more rapidly and uniformly than the wild variety. Legume seeds also increased in size during domestication, as shown in this comparison of wild and domesticated seeds. Both the cereals and the legumes were self-pollinated, and this greatly facilitated domestication because they remained stable over multiple generations. Domesticated maize evolved from one of the teosintes, Zea maize subspecies parviglumus. This photo shows Paul Gepps from UC Davis admiring the ancestor of domesticated maize. Note the presence of branches on teosinte, but not on domesticated maize. The transformation of teosinte into maize was one of the most dramatic changes in the history of plant domestication. The major change was the faciation of the teosinte inflorescence caused by a series of mutations, giving rise to the maize cob with its numerous rows of kernels. Faciation refers to the fusion of plant meristems resulting in a fused stem or reproductive structure. An example of faciation in senecio or ragwort is shown in the lower left corner of the slide. In a similar fashion, faciation of the ear of teosinte led to the development of the modern cob of corn. Recent studies have identified a maize gene that regulates the number of rows of kernels in maize cobs. Such genes that regulate faciation could potentially increase the yields of other cereals. Imagine, for example, a cob of wheat. Between about 3000 BCE and 800 CE, the population grew fivefold from 50 million to 250 million people. How did agriculture keep pace with this population growth? During this period, agriculture spread from its centers of domestication throughout Eurasia and the Americas. As more and more people took up farming, more and more forests were cleared and cultivated. Oxen and later horses were harnessed to plows for the first time, greatly increasing the efficiency of cultivation. Farmers learned to fertilize their soils with animal manure and by planting legumes, the so-called green manures. Crop rotation and fallowing were also practiced for the first time. Many new perennial crops, especially fruit and nut trees and vines, were domesticated. Unlike the annual crops, the perennial crops were mostly outcrossers, so they wouldn't breed true from seed. Therefore, they had to be propagated clonally or by grafting. In the case of dioecious species comprised of male and female individuals, such as dates, figs, and pistachios, artificial pollination was practiced. However, this technique was never applied to any of the annual plants because it still wasn't understood in sexual terms. This was also the period when most of our modern-day vegetables were domesticated in both the old and new worlds. The coal crops, a highly diverse group of vegetables, were all derived from the wild cabbage Brassica oleracea. Each of the domesticated varieties represents a mutation in one or more developmental genes. Between 800 and 1825, a period of 1,000 years, the population quadrupled in size to 1 billion people. During this period, crops became globalized by two important historical events. First, the spread of Islam brought Asian and African crops to Europe and vice versa. Second, the arrival of Columbus in the New World led to the exchange of New World and European crops known as the Columbian Exchange. In addition to livestock, Europeans brought other animals that facilitated agriculture. For example, earthworms, which had died out in the northeastern US during the last ice age, transformed the forests of New England by digesting all the surface litter to which the trees had become adapted. They also conditioned the soil for future agriculture. The importation of European honeybees, which are pollination generalists, ensured that the newly arrived Old World crops would be pollinated. And imported draft animals provided the power for plowing land. This was a period in which there was considerable expansion of arable land by deforestation and the plowing of grasslands. Crop yields were further enhanced by the practice of drilling crops in rows instead of by scattering seed. And a four-course system of rotation in England and elsewhere was developed, in which wheat and barley were alternated with turnips and clover, with turnips being used as animal feed, resulting in the production of manure, and clover enriching the soil through nitrogen fixation. The four-course rotation procedure increased yields by 50%. It took 200,000 years for the human population to reach 1 billion people, but only 100 years to go from 1 billion to 2 billion in the 1920s. The most important factor enabling the food supply to keep pace with population growth was farmland expansion. During this period, there was a doubling of the land cleared for agriculture in the US and a tripling of the arable land in Russia. The map on the top shows the distribution of wheat production in the US in 1839. And the bottom map shows wheat production 70 years later in 1909. Note that wheat production spread westward during this period. This westward expansion was made possible by extensive breeding programs, which created new wheat varieties that could be grown in these regions, and it resulted in an eightfold increase in wheat production in the US. This same period also saw the beginning of agricultural science. Major gains in crop yields were achieved as the result of increased scientific understanding of plant nutrition and disease. An important breakthrough was Liebig's demonstration that nitrogen, potassium, and phosphate were essential nutrients. Liebig's law of the minimum, published in 1840, which stated that crop yields are always limited by the essential nutrient in shortest supply, came as a revelation to farmers who had assumed that soil fertility mainly depended on the amount of nitrogen. Of course, nitrogen was the limiting factor for soil fertility in most cases. So the importation of nitrogen-rich fertilizers from the New World in the form of Chilean nitrate and Peruvian guano greatly increased crop yields in Europe, as did German potash or potassium salts and superphosphate, the soluble form of phosphate. By the early 20th century, however, the supply of cheap nitrogen fertilizer from South America was beginning to decline. Fortunately, the Haber-Bosch process for industrial nitrogen fixation came along in 1913 in Germany, providing a virtually unlimited supply of cheap nitrogen fertilizer for farming. The other breakthroughs came in the form of copper-based fungicides and insecticides, both of which were pioneered in France. Bordeaux mixture was first used to protect grapes from downy mildew. And Paris Green, once used to kill rats in Paris sewers, was found at lower concentrations to protect crops like potatoes from insect pests. In addition, important theoretical advances laid the foundation for future increases in crop yields. These include the identification of several trace elements, such as calcium, magnesium, sulfur, and iron, the discovery of nitrogen fixation in legume root nodules, the advent of Mendelian genetics, which greatly accelerated the process of plant breeding, the discovery of photoperiodism, which facilitated breeding for new varieties adapted to different latitudes, and the first discovery of a plant hormone, the growth hormone auxin. The population went from 2 billion to 3 billion from 1927 to 1960. And this time, it took only 33 years to add another billion people. A 53% increase in arable farmland during this period made it possible to feed all those hungry mouths. The 20th century's greatest expansion of farmland took place in Brazil, where the arable land increased tenfold between 1900 and 1950. Farm mechanization also enabled farms to be more efficient and productive, replacing mules, horses, and people. DDT was introduced to protect crops from insects. DDT was extremely effective and much less toxic than the older insecticides. And the synthetic auxin 2,4-D was widely used as an herbicide for cereal crops. Plant breeders also began to use irradiation and chemical mutagens to increase the mutation rate and speed up artificial selection. And the alkaloid colchicine from the autumn crocus was introduced to induce polyploidy, which means having one or more extra sets of chromosomes. Colchicine-induced polyploidization has been used to create new fertile hybrids, such as the wheat-rye hybrid triticale. Finally, hybrid maize was introduced, doubling U.S. maize yields over this period. As shown in the graph at the bottom of the slide, as more acreage was sown to hybrid varieties, the maize yields increased dramatically, as did the use of nitrogen fertilizer and herbicides. Although the new hybrid varieties led to bumper crops, there were some negative environmental impacts of these advances as well. In her influential book, Silent Spring, published in 1962, Rachel Carson brought the toxic effects of DDT to the public's attention. The overuse of herbicides was also a problem, as was the overapplication of fertilizers, which got into the water supply and caused algal blooms. Increased water usage for irrigation led to the overpumping of aquifers, while farm mechanization and the liberal use of fertilizers consumed large amounts of fossil fuel. Perhaps most troubling, the growing cost of modern agriculture began to open a huge gap in food availability between rich and poor nations. The world population reached 4 billion in 1975, and this time it took only 15 years to add the next billion people. The biggest gain in food supply was the result of the so-called Green Revolution. The term Green Revolution refers to the introduction in the 1960s of high-yielding semi-dwarf varieties of wheat and rice. The semi-dwarf varieties developed by the American plant biologist Norman Borlaug, working in Mexico, responded to nitrogen fertilizer without lodging or falling over, as the traditional varieties did, and they were disease-resistant as well. Mutations in the RHT gene, which regulates the response to the hormone gibberellin, were responsible for the small stature of the semi-dwarf wheat. As shown in the graph on the left, the new semi-dwarf varieties have a much higher grain-to-stalk ratio, or harvest index. This led to a tripling of the wheat and rice yields in developing countries, the graph on the right, which was all the more remarkable because it occurred with only a negligible increase in the amount of farmland. On the negative side of the ledger, however, the new crops increased the amount of fertilizer, pesticide, and water used in agriculture still further and caused a large decrease in crop genetic diversity as well. So there were significant environmental downsides to the Green Revolution. Other factors that increased yields and helped to feed the 4 billion people were the switch to multiple cropping in Asian countries, the introduction of Roundup as an herbicide, which was extremely effective and less environmentally hazardous than the older herbicides, the introduction of tissue culture techniques for clonal propagation, the first use of chemical selection in plant breeding, which led to the creation of canola oil by eliminating erucic acid from Brassica napus seeds. And last but not least, the discovery of the TI plasmid of Agrobacterium in 1974 set the stage for the creation of an ever-expanding list of genetically engineered, or GE, crops. Plasmids are small circles of DNA in bacterial cells, distinct from the chromosome, that contain genes that benefit the organism, like antibiotic resistance genes. Agrobacterium causes crown gall disease in plants, and the tumor-inducing genes are located on the plasmid. The TI plasmid can insert its genes, called tDNA, directly into the plant chromosome, which programs the cell to synthesize hormones and food for the bacterium. As I'll discuss in a moment, the TI plasmid can be used to insert other genes of interest into the plant genome, creating transgenic plants. We went from 4 to 5 billion in only 11 years, from 1975 to 1986. Thanks largely to the continuing benefits of the Green Revolution, the food supply kept pace with population growth without increasing the amount of farmland. As shown in the graph, wheat and rice yields kept pace with the increase in population. But this increase in crop yield was accompanied by a big increase in nitrogen fertilizer use. Promising new developments included the beginning of no-till and minimum tillage agriculture, which can decrease soil erosion, soil oxidation, and fuel consumption. However, weeds are a major problem with no-till agriculture, which restricted its use. Much progress was made in genetic engineering during the 1980s. Plant transformation was achieved using the TI plasmid and the DNA gun. To use the TI plasmid, the gene of interest was substituted for the plant hormone biosynthetic genes and a second gene encoding a selectable marker, such as an antibiotic resistance gene, was also inserted. Using these techniques, the bacterial gene for BT toxin was put into plants, making them resistant to insects. BT is a group of specific insect toxins produced by the bacterium Bacillus thuringiensis. It functions by forming pores in the midgut of insects, causing the cells to leak. The toxin itself has been used as an insecticide by organic farmers for the past 40 years, and there is no evidence of any harmful effects to mammals, including humans. In addition to insect resistance, the first virus-resistant plants were produced by transforming plants with virus coat protein genes, which induces a kind of immunity to the virus. It took roughly the same amount of time, 15 years, to go from 5 billion to 6 billion as it took previously to go from 4 billion to 5 billion in the year 2000. Unfortunately, the growth rate of cereal production fell to 1% per year, down from 1.6% in the 1980s and almost 3% in the 1970s. This was partly due to the exhaustion of the benefits derived from the Green Revolution. The first genetically engineered crop was unveiled in 1994, the Flavor Saver tomato. Flavor Saver had been transformed with the antisense gene for polygalacturones, which inhibited the enzyme and slowed down the rate of fruit softening. In theory, this would allow the tomato to ripen on the vine before being picked and shipped. However, Flavor Saver tomatoes still softened enough during shipping to require expensive packaging, so it was withdrawn from the market in 1996. The year 1996 also saw the introduction of the first Roundup-resistant crops, which were quickly adopted by farmers around the world. The use of the herbicide in conjunction with minimum tillage agriculture prevents soil erosion and reduces greenhouse gas emission caused by soil oxidation. By 2013, 93% of all soybeans and 85% of all feed corn grown in the USA were Roundup resistant. In 1995, the first BT maize crop was put on the market. By 1999, 12 million hectares of BT maize, potato, and cotton were being grown globally, significantly reducing the amount of pesticide use. In addition, the phenomenon of co-suppression was discovered in petunia. The mechanism of co-suppression was subsequently shown to be based on a process called RNA interference, or RNAi. And RNAi turned out to be the basis of virus resistance induced by overexpressing viral coat proteins. Soon, a number of virus-resistant crop plants were produced, including potato, tomato, papaya, squash, and bean. The first wave of GE plants was generated using antibiotic resistance genes as selectable markers, which alarmed a lot of people. However, this is no longer an issue. Nowadays, it is possible to use other types of selectable markers, and techniques have even been developed to produce marker-free GE crops that contain no antibiotic resistance genes or any other selectable marker. Which brings us to 2014. Today, the human population stands at about 7 billion people. Although crop production is still increasing, it is increasing at a far slower rate than in the 1960s, indicating that the benefits of the Green Revolution are effectively over. We need a second Green Revolution. Despite opposition in some countries, more and more farmers around the world are planting GE crops, mostly for animal feed and as ingredients in processed foods. The total land area planted in GE crops is now 100 times more than it was in 1996, and it is equivalent in area to the state of Alaska. The U.S. is still the largest planter of GE crops, with Brazil the next largest. An encouraging sign is that the area of land planted in GE crops in the developing world, where they are most needed, is now equal to that in the developed world, shown in the red and blue curves. The right-hand graph. Most of the GE corn and soybeans are used in cattle feed or as ingredients in processed foods, As much as 80% of U.S. processed foods contains an ingredient from a GE crop, such as cornstarch, high fructose corn syrup, corn oil, canola oil, soybean oil, soy flour, soy lecithin, and cottonseed oil. A few fruits and vegetables for human consumption are genetically engineered. The Hawaiian papaya, plums, and some squash, zucchini, and sweet corn. China is currently growing insect-resistant poplar trees. Among the benefits of BT crops is a decrease in pesticide use. Since 1996, pesticide use has declined 37% globally because of the use of BT crops. On the negative side of the ledger, some weeds have evolved resistance to Roundup, and some insects have developed resistance to BT toxins. One of the most effective tools to prevent the spread of insect resistance to BT is the refuge strategy. BT resistance is conferred by one gene with two alleles, R and S. The resistance allele R is recessive, and the susceptible allele S is dominant. So both SS and RS are susceptible to BT. In a typical field of BT maize, the appearance of BT-resistant insects is extremely rare. To become resistant, the insect must acquire two copies of the resistant allele RR. If a border of non-BT maize is planted around the BT crop, none of the insects in the refuge will develop BT resistance. All of them will contain two copies of the susceptible allele SS. The presence of refugia ensures that the chance of a rare BT-resistant individual mating with another BT-resistant individual is effectively zero. The progeny of the resistant and susceptible insect will always be RS, that is, susceptible to BT, and will therefore be killed. For better or worse, agriculture dominates the planet today. This slide is taken from a 2010 article in Nature, which highlights Brazilian agriculture. Brazil's agricultural output has been increasing faster than in any other country, most notably in the tropical savanna region, or Cerrado. What's happening in the Cerrado illustrates just how dominant agriculture can be. And as with all major gains in food production, it comes at an environmental cost. For example, agriculture takes up 40% of the global land area, which includes 12% for food crops and 28% for pastures. Agriculture also uses 70% of the global water supply and generates 30% of greenhouse gases. In addition, agriculture is a major source of nitrogen and phosphorus flows in the ecosystem and a major driver of biodiversity loss. Agriculture is indeed a Faustian bargain. In the immortal words of Pogo, we have met the enemy, and he is us. Despite the dominance of agriculture, hunger and malnutrition persist in the developing world. Nearly 1 billion people, about 70% of whom are located in Asia and East Africa, are malnourished. Yet, we're in the midst of a global obesity epidemic. There are now about 1.6 billion obese people globally. The problem is that some people are getting enough food for two or three people, while others are going hungry. Here we have a 2005 map showing the global distribution of obesity. The US and Mexico, I believe, are now the current leaders. The existence of hunger and malnutrition alongside of an obesity epidemic tells us that a major cause of malnutrition today is political, as Lester Brown and many others have pointed out. Economic improvement in developing countries must be part of any comprehensive solution. However, As economic conditions in developing countries improve, the new middle classes are wanting to eat more meat. The upper graph shows the rising gross domestic product of, or GDP, of developing countries from 1960 to 2004. While the lower graph shows the relationship between GDP and meat consumption. As GDP goes up in these countries, so will the demand for meat, which will require even higher crop production to feed all the additional livestock. To keep pace with both population growth and economic improvement, the prevailing opinion is we will have to double the current rate of food production in order to feed 10 billion people by 2050. Ray et al. Have calculated that crop yields would have to grow at a rate of 2.4% per year. But as shown in this graph, the current world crop yields for maize, rice, wheat, and soybeans fall well short of 2.4%, as indicated by the dashed lines. In fact, crop yields are increasing at less than half the required rate. And this assumes that the population stabilizes by 2050. But contrary to UN projections, the world population may not stabilize this century, increasing instead to around 11 billion by 2100. If so, we would have to more than double the current rate of crop productivity to feed all these people. Could we increase crop production as we have in the past by expanding the amount of croplands? The map on the left shows the current global distribution of arable farmland. The map on the right shows the total amount of potential farmland. As you can see, the amount of potential croplands is larger than the current croplands. So the answer to the question is yes, we could potentially increase the amount of arable farmland, but it would come at a prohibitive ecological cost. Most potential croplands are biodiversity hotspots. These hotspots have already lost 70% of their original vegetation, yet they contain 50% of the world's plant species, which will disappear if we turn them into farms. Nearly 30% of all plant species have not even been discovered yet, among which may be species that hold the key to our survival in the future. We simply can't afford to destroy the last remaining biodiversity hotspots on the planet. Another factor limiting our ability to increase the area of arable land for food crops is competition with biofuels. World ethanol and biodiesel production have been increasing steadily since 2005 with no end in sight. The increase in arable land for biofuels will come at the expense of farmland. Arable land is also shrinking, due to a lethal combination of urban sprawl, soil salination, and desertification. In summary then, expanding farmland is not an option. Only by doubling crop yields per hectare can we hope to feed 10 billion people by 2050. But an even larger threat to agriculture looms on the horizon, global warming. Left unchecked, climate change will pose big problems for agriculture in the future. This illustration from a special issue of Time magazine shows how the buildup of greenhouse gases will trigger a cascade of by now familiar environmental consequences caused by the greenhouse effect. I'll list them in the order shown in the slide. First, the burning of fossil fuels is releasing billions of tons of CO2 into the atmosphere every year. Second, CO2 accumulation causes a rise in global temperature due to the greenhouse effect. As a result, the temperature is projected to rise anywhere from 2 degrees Celsius to 6 degrees Celsius by the end of the century. Third, rising temperatures will dry out forests, leading to more forest fires, and forest fires release more CO2 to the atmosphere, raising the temperature once again. Fourth, rising temperatures will thaw permafrost in the Arctic region, releasing vast amounts of methane and CO2 into the atmosphere, raising the temperature once again. Fifth, the melting of Arctic ice means that more sunlight is absorbed by the ocean, raising its temperature even further. And sixth, the melting of ice sheets from both Greenland and Antarctica would increase the sea level by 72 meters, 220 feet. But even a partial melting could cause sea levels to rise enough to submerge coastal areas, reducing the amount of arable land still further. Global warming will also affect rainfall patterns. Some areas may receive greater than average rainfall, while others will receive less than normal rainfall. The subtropics, shown in yellow on this map, are predicted to become drier. This will affect not only agricultural productivity, but the productivity of natural ecosystems as well. Perhaps most troubling, the melting of mountain glaciers around the world would dry up rivers, devastating irrigation-dependent agriculture. For example, the spring melt from Himalayan and Tibetan plateau glaciers feeds the Indus, Ganges, Yangtze, Mekong, and Yellow rivers. Hundreds of millions of people depend on these rivers for crop irrigation. High temperatures will also have numerous deleterious effects on crop growth, including increased evapotranspiration rates, decreased germination rates, inhibition of photosynthesis, alteration of flowering times, inhibition of sexual reproduction, especially pollen tube development, and increase in plant diseases and herbivore attacks. As a result, the IPCC, or Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has recently projected net reductions in crop yields starting in 2030. In the graph, the blue bars indicate increases in yields, because, of course, some places are going to get wetter. And the brown bars indicate crop yield decreases. The decreases far outstrip the increases by the end of the century. So, is the situation hopeless? Absolutely not. In the remainder of the talk, I'll explain why I'm still optimistic that we can stave off a Malthusian fate. In the first place, fanfare please, plant biologists have never had such a powerful array of molecular tools at their disposal to tackle the challenge of increasing crop productivity in the face of climate change. Thanks to the rapid advances in DNA sequencing, we now have an ever-expanding database of genomes and other DNA and RNA sequences, such as transcriptomes, expression profiles, et cetera, et cetera. Don't worry about the technical jargon. The bottom line is that these genomic databases can be correlated with a range of other kinds of data to infer gene function. With a better understanding of gene function, we can potentially genetically engineer new traits into crops that will not only increase their yields and nutritional value, but will enable them to thrive even under the adverse conditions that may result from climate change, buying us needed time to stabilize the population at a sustainable level. An example of nutritional fortification is golden rice, developed by the Swiss plant biologist Ingo Patricus, which has been given two additional genes that enable it to produce beta-carotene, the precursor of vitamin A. Vitamin A deficiency causes 1 to 2 million deaths and 500,000 cases of irreversible blindness annually, and it primarily affects developing countries. Golden rice has been shown to be a better source of vitamin A than spinach, yet it is banned because it is a GA crop, even though it has been offered free of charge and is available in a marker-free form without any antibiotic resistance genes. Because of climate change, considerable attention is being given to the development of drought-resistant crops, and these efforts are starting to bear fruit. The wild-type tobacco plants on the left were subjected to severe drought conditions, and you can see the results. In contrast, the plants on the right contain a single transgene from another plant that allowed it to synthesize higher levels of the plant hormone cytokinin when subjected to water stress. This enabled the plants to thrive despite the drought conditions. This same gene has been put into wheat and other food crop plants and is now being field tested. Effects are also underway to develop salt-tolerant plants. In this example, the addition of a single plant gene encoding an enzyme that my lab helped to characterize, the vacuolar pyrophosphatase, confers salt tolerance in barley. The GE barley plants not only survive in high salt soil, their yield of grain, which is shown in the blue bars in the graphs, is much higher than that of the wild type, shown by the green bars. In Southeast Asia, flooding in rain-fed and flood-prone areas is expected to increase as a consequence of sea level rise and extreme weather conditions. GE crops can alleviate this problem. For example, the field of Swarna rice growing in India on the left shows the effects of complete submergence on the wild-type grain. In contrast, the field on the right shows the flood-tolerant GE rice variety, Swarna sub 1, which can tolerate complete submergence and produce normal yields. Overapplication of nitrogen fertilizers has been a major source of water pollution around agricultural lands, especially after the Green Revolution. Improving nitrogen use efficiency through genetic engineering can reduce the need for nitrogen fertilizers. Here, for example, are four Brassica napus seedlings growing in nitrogen-deficient soil. Plants 1, 2, and 4 contain the gene for the enzyme alanine aminotransferase from barley, while plant number 3 is the wild type. The addition of this one transgene enables the plant to take up nitrogen much more efficiently from the soil. As temperature rises, plants will become more susceptible to various diseases. But now that we're beginning to understand the mechanism of plant disease resistance, genetic engineering can create disease-resistant crops much faster and more effectively than is possible by traditional breeding. For example, GE walnut trees have been developed that are resistant to both nematodes and crown gall disease. In this case, RNA interference, or RNAi, was used to inhibit the growth of the pathogens. The wild type is on the left, the GE walnut is on the right. In Hawaii, the papaya industry was almost wiped out by papaya ring spot virus, but was saved by the development of new virus-resistant GE varieties, which have been approved for planting. In sub-Saharan Africa, brown streak virus is spreading rapidly and annihilating cassava crops. A program was begun to produce virus-resistant cassava with positive results. These GE cassava seedlings were made resistant to the virus using RNAi and are currently being tested in several African countries. And speaking of virus diseases, let's not forget Ebola. Plants don't get it, but people do. And plant biologists are using GE tobacco plants to synthesize enough of the new experimental drug ZMapp to help prevent the spread of the disease. Besides protecting our current crops from diseases, genetic engineering can also make an important contribution to conservation biology. Starting at the turn of the century, the American chestnut was nearly wiped out by the bark blight fungus, probably originally from Asia, which killed over 3 billion trees in the eastern US from Georgia to Maine. The fungus penetrates the bark by secreting oxalic acid. The addition of a single transgene from wheat that encodes an enzyme that degrades oxalic acid makes the tree resistant to the fungus. Thus, we can look forward to the return of the American chestnut to our eastern forests in our own lifetimes. And work is also underway to restore the American elm. But GE crops are only part of the solution. It's becoming increasingly apparent that chronically low soil carbon content is one of the weakest links in conventional agriculture. Carbon-poor soils are unhealthy soils. They require more water and more chemical fertilizer to grow crops. Here is a map showing the widespread occurrence of soil degradation. The only stable soils are the yellow regions. The main cause of soil degradation is the loss of organic carbon due to oxidation to CO2. In fact, most of the CO2 emitted to the atmosphere comes from the soil. This diagram shows the estimated annual carbon fluxes in billions of tons or gigatons. The net release of CO2 by the ocean is zero, while the biosphere, thanks to green plants, takes up CO2. The soil is by far the largest source of CO2 on the planet, 60 billion tons or gigatons annually, much of it due to agriculture. How much is a gigaton? The General Sherman tree weighs about 5,000 tons. So 1 gigaton equals 200,000 General Sherman trees. The contribution of fossil fuel to the atmosphere is surprisingly small compared to that of soil, only 5 to 6 gigatons compared to 60 gigatons from the soil. That's shown in the lower right corner. The soil is also a huge reservoir of carbon, nearly as much as in the atmosphere, and most of it is located in the upper meter, but it could hold a lot more. Based on these numbers, there are 3 obvious steps we need to take to reduce CO2 and mitigate climate change. Reduce forest deforestation, reduce industrial emissions, and increase soil organic carbon content. How much organic carbon would we have to add to the soil to mitigate global warming? Let's say we wanted to sequester a total of 7 gigatons in the soil, which would completely cancel out the effects of fossil fuels. There are about 3.5 billion acres of arable land. So that would require the addition of only 2 tons of carbon per acre, which would fit on the back of a pickup truck. In other words, it's doable. But the benefits of adding more organic carbon to the soil go beyond mitigation of global warming. Plowing, which promotes CO2 release, also degrades soil structure by disrupting mycorrhizal fungi, which are important for soil structure, water retention, and fertility. Here, for example, is a typical pine seedling with its extensive network of mycorrhizal fungal filaments. Mycorrhizal fungi not only enhance nutrient uptake by plant roots, They also form the basis of soil microaggregates, which maintain soil structure by promoting the porosity of the soil, soil water retention, and soil carbon stabilization. Plowing slices and dices these mycorrhizal networks, leading to the destruction of soil structure. One way to prevent this from happening is to use no-till or minimum-till agriculture. Despite a burgeoning population, humanity has thus far managed to avoid falling off the Malthusian cliff. Yet no one doubts the correctness of Malthus's basic idea that unchecked population growth is unsustainable. Human-induced climate change has made the current unsustainable trend even more unsustainable. We should not underestimate the challenges we face. To feed the 10 or 11 billion on a warming planet, we will need every tool in our toolkit. Genetic engineering is simply the latest advance in a long history of genetic modification that began 10,000 years ago with the agricultural revolution. Now that the Green Revolution has run its course, we need a second green revolution, one that is greener than the first, which some have dubbed the Evergreen Revolution. My definition of the Evergreen Revolution is one that combines the speed and specificity of genetic engineering with the sustainability of conservation agriculture. We are fortunate to have one of the world's premier agroecology programs right here at UC Santa Cruz. However, sustainability will also require geopolitical reforms that reduce poverty and empower developing nations to become self-sufficient in food production. There are so many opportunities to save ourselves. The only question is whether we will seize them. Thank you.
Given this great amount of information, if you are like me, you probably couldn't follow all the details. Let me announce that the whole thing has been taken by a video that will be available online in the Emeriti website. So if you want to follow up with further details, you can look at the website. We now have the possibility of having some questions. Oh, and let me tell you that at the end there will be some refreshments afterwards outside. So let's start. If there are any questions, raise your hand, and we have two ushers that will.
Lincoln, you didn't address very much the drought situation we're in right now. Could you say something about the drought effect and how much water is going to play a role in it in a little more detail?
You mean locally in Santa Cruz? Oh, I think I have this still.
Worldwide.
I'm still might, yeah.
World in agricultural.
Oh, in mostly. For agricultural in general, yeah. First of all, in the subtropics, they're going to be hit the hardest. And that's going to happen, by 2030 is sort of the tipping point when yields start to go down, and drought is a major reason why the yields are going to go down. What scares me the most, though, is the long-term effects on the mountain glaciers, because so much irrigation agriculture depends on those glaciers, and you know, by all accounts, they're melting at an alarmingly rapid rate. So what if those ever go, we're in deep trouble.
Hi, over here on the other side. Thanks for the very interesting talk. One thing I am starting to hear more about lately that is kind of related to this whole thing of pulling carbon out of the atmosphere using, you know, biological means. I'm sure you know about this guy, Alan Savory, and a whole suite of researchers who are all into using big old animals, you know, cows, buffalo, whatever, returning to those days somehow in some modern way to end up sequestering carbon in the soil, that soil being that big reservoir, and that somehow that'll green everything up and restore the atmosphere back to pre-industrial levels. It'd be great if that were true, but I'm just wondering what your take is on that, and I don't know if you can speak on behalf of Steve Gleisman. I don't know if he's here, but he's another guy I'd like to ask about that, but you guys probably should.
So you're talking about the use of more farm animals to generate manure to
whatever it is that they say happens. They show these pictures of how, you know, it was totally barren land, you know, in 2004, and then they started doing this grazing stuff.
Yeah.
And by now it's just verdant and magic.
Well, I think that I mean that will work on a small scale for, you know, certain, for a niche market of agriculture, but in terms of mass agriculture feeding 10 or 11 billion people, I don't think that's practical.
Yeah, can you say something about the technical means of restoring these vast amounts of carbon back to the soil, how that would be done?
Yes, well, this is, I think we need a lot more work on how, because, of course, growing, the two means that we have, I mean, you could bury the carbon in the form, you know, trees and logs and things, you could be buried. But what I'm talking about is cover crops and crop rotation. Year-round cover crops, there are several states that mandate year-round cover crops. And when you have year-round cover crops, you prevent erosion, first of all, and you also absorb a lot of excess nitrates and things that would normally run off into the water. But more importantly, you can then plow that back into the soil. Now, they're working on various ways to plow in such a way as to be the least disruptive of the mycorrhizal fungal associates that are found with plant roots. Because if you destroy those mycorrhizal networks, then you do degrade soil structure. So the trick is to do not no-till agriculture, but minimum-till agriculture, where you take the cover crop and you do a very gentle plowing underneath and get it underneath as deep as you can into the soil. But this is an area that still needs a lot of work. I mean, we need to figure out what's the best way of getting cover crops and back down into the soil. There are various kinds of plow methods that have been developed, but I think they haven't been perfected yet. But I think it's, if we, considering we can, we have space programs and things, surely we can figure out how to plow cover crops into the soil with minimum damage. And if we do this all over the world, we can reduce CO2 in the atmosphere significantly.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. That was an outstanding presentation. My question to you, is there any reason to be concerned with consuming GMO foods?
Well, if you're asking me, there's no scientific evidence that it does, that it's harmful to eat GE foods. And this has been studied all over the world. Every scientific, you know, academy has stated that they're no more dangerous than conventional crops to eat. So there's no scientific evidence that GE crops are unsafe to eat. Absolutely none. When the Flavor Saver tomato came out, we got a crate of it in Sinsheimer Labs, and I was eating them. They were great. I mean, I wouldn't hesitate to eat them. And they've been cattle have been eating GE soybeans and corn for years and years and years, and there's no harm to the livestock that are eating it now. And there's a lot of GE food. There are GE foods that are being eaten, like papaya in Hawaii and plums and various things. A lot of GE products are in processed foods. You know, there's no harm or has ever been reported for any use of GE ingredients in processed foods. So, the answer is no. There's no scientific evidence whatsoever for any harm, danger from eating them.
Hi, over here, sorry. Thank you for this presentation. What I'm still kind of wondering about is, you give me faith that we could feed everybody and take care of climate change in the process, which is really cool. What about the other threats that human population is causing? Collapse of the marine ecosystems and these other factors that could ultimately put us in check if we don't put ourselves in check.
Oh, yeah. No, you're absolutely right. I'm, of course, just focusing on crops and food and feeding people. But you're right. I mean, the ocean is a whole other area. But, of course, the problems we're having in the ocean, besides overfishing and things like that, is the ocean acidification, which is due to too much CO2. And I just think that's something that we could at least ameliorate significantly if we put enough organic carbon into the soil. I mean, only 2 tons per acre of arable land on the planet, and that's 7 gigatons of CO2, more than is given off by all the use of fossil fuel. We basically cancel out the contribution of fossil fuel. We could radically bring down CO2 in the atmosphere, the oceans would start to heal. Of course, human behavior is another issue, right? You know, overfishing, these are social issues that need to be addressed.
This is following up on the genetic modified question. The tests that have shown no detriment to humans from eating that. What I've heard is that it's the residues of Roundup on these crops then, because that's the reason to genetically modify a lot of them, is right. So that Roundup can be used. It's the Roundup.
Okay, residues. Roundup is another story. Or, first of all, you know, Roundup as an herbicide is probably the least dangerous herbicide we've ever produced. I mean, but I agree with you. Roundup, you don't want to be eating too much herbicide of any kind. At least I don't. I mean, I shop at New Leash, and so I want to establish my credentials here. But I agree with you. But so one of the things that we need to do under conservation agriculture is precision farming. The problem with herbicides is not so much that we shouldn't ever use herbicides. Sometimes you need to use herbicides or you lose the crop. But with precision farming, this holds out the potential to be much more precise in where we apply it. So we only apply the herbicide exactly where it's needed and also how much to apply. I mean, we have just come out of sort of the dark ages of using herbicides and fertilizer, where we just thought the more, the better. But now we know that we have really caused terrible environmental impact by doing that. And what we need to do now is to get much smarter about how much we apply and where we apply it. And with precision agriculture, we had the potential to do that. And I think that, but I would argue that under certain circumstances, for example, minimum tillage agriculture. One of the reasons farmers plow land is to get rid of the weeds. If you stop doing all that plowing, which causes CO2 to come out of the ground, you're gonna have way more weeds. So the reason they develop Roundup-resistant crops is that if you do less plowing, you can take care of some of those weeds with this herbicide. So what we need to do is get the right balance, and we need to do it in a smart way so that we only do it where it's needed, when it's needed.
I have a question related to whether you think the biotech market-driven industry can be trusted. I remember the Flavor Saver tomato, and when I heard about that, I was absolutely horrified. Here they were using this greatest technology not to feed more people, not to feed people more nutritiously, but just to make more profit for the food industry.
Okay, so, I mean, that's a big question. And, I mean, for the one reason why industry does these things is the government doesn't spend enough money in the universities. If we had more university funding for research on these problems, we'd be doing it all. Most of the research on GE crops that industry does has to do with herbicides and pesticides. Most of the GE crops that I showed you were developed in universities, and you know, having to do with fortification. For example, GE rice was the golden rice was given to the world free of charge. Nobody makes a dime on it, but no one will plant it. So what we're dealing with is not the bad industry. We're dealing with a prejudice against a plant that has had one gene put into it, or you know, using biochemistry to do it instead of the usual breeding method. But you can't transfer one gene by breeding. When you breed, by definition, you mix thousands of genes between two different varieties. What GE technology allows you to do is to target only one gene, one that you need, to make the plant grow the way you want it to grow. So it's not the bad industry that's causing the problem. It's that people are biased against the whole idea for some reason. I think it's just slow to accept it for some reason. But you know, more and more people are using it because there are clear benefits to use it. And we, you know, if the climate really, if the situation gets as bad as we worry that it might get, we're going to need those GE crops.
So, yes. You spoke a lot on, or you did mention that with the diversification of agriculture, but with genetic engineering, how is that a diverse set of genes out on the field? It's more of emphasizing a monoculture rather than having a polyculture that could be more resistant to some.
So you're saying that a GE crop is increasing, we're losing biodiversity. I agree with you, but remember agriculture itself, you know, is the Faustian bargain. You know, anything you do in agriculture hurts the environment. You know, that's what agriculture does. But let me tell you this, just because it doesn't have to reduce biodiversity, you could take one gene and put it into multiple varieties. In fact, that's what they're doing now. You can put that gene not into just one variety, but 100 or 200 varieties. And now you have the 200 varieties with that transgene in it. In other words, you can easily create more diversity of GE plants. GE plants can be diverse too. You just have to put it into many, many varieties, not just one.
How does a small farmer continue to save those seeds?
Well, only, it's not true that Monsanto thought about not allowing, you know, putting in that terminator gene that would, But you know, they pulled out of that. Now, as far as a certain like hybrid maize, you have to buy. That's not a GE crop, but hybrid maize. You're supposed to buy that from the company, and that's what capitalism is. I mean, these are companies out to make a profit. They make the seeds. They want a profit from it. I keep saying, you know, if you don't like companies, tell your government to support more research in the universities. And that's, we only have those two. If the government, if the universities aren't getting enough money to do it, the company, some company will step in and do it for us. And they're going to want to make money.
Well, I think this is a good time to continue the discussion.
Thank you.
Thank our speakers.